Jesus at the center of it all.
For the Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they wash their hands in a special way, holding the tradition of the elders. When they come from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they wash. And there are many other things which they have received and hold, like the washing of cups, of pitchers, copper vessels, and couches. Couches. Then the Pharisees and scribes asked him, "Why do your disciples not walk according to the tradition of the elders, but eat bread with unwashed hands?" He answered and said to them, "Well, did Isaiah prophesy of you hypocrites? As it is written, 'This people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. And in vain they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men.' For laying aside the commandment of God, you hold the tradition of men, the washing of pitchers and cups and many other such things you do." He said to them, "All too well you reject the commandment of God that you may keep your tradition. For Moses said, 'Honor your father and your mother, and he who curses father or mother, let him be put to death.' But you say, 'If a man says to his father or mother, whatever profit you might have received from me is korban, that is a gift to God,' then you no longer let him do anything for his father or his mother, making the word of God of no effect through your tradition which you have handed down. And many other such things you do." Now, when he had called all the multitude to himself, he said to them, "Hear me, everyone, and understand. There is nothing that enters a man from outside which can defile him. But the things which come out of him, those are the things that defile a man. If anyone has ears to hear, let him hear." Now, when he had entered a house away from the crowd, his disciples asked him concerning the parable. So he said to them, "Are you thus without understanding also? Do you not perceive that whatever enters a man from outside cannot defile him, because it does not enter his heart but his stomach, and is eliminated, thus purifying all foods? And he said, 'What comes out of a man, that defiles a man. For from within, out of the heart of men, proceed evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murders, thefts, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lewdness, an evil eye, blasphemy, pride, foolishness. All these evil things come from within and defile a man.'" And after he had spoken these things, he departed for another place. All right, so this is where the sermon ends. This whole passage that you have read is divided into three sections. I mean, I divide it into three sections. So the first section or the first point is actually the catalyst for this exposition that Jesus said, that Jesus taught. What was it that caused him to speak of these things? The second thing is the perspective that he wanted the people to see. And last of all is the standard to which he expects, or the law expects us to live to, all right? So the catalyst, what's the catalyst? What's the catalyst? The question from the Pharisees, right? Okay, let me walk here. Normally, I walk and see everyone first. Make sure everybody is awake. Okay. No lah, I want to see the beautiful people of God. Amen? All right, it's good to come together. Now, okay. The catalyst, Mark 7, verse 5. "Then the Pharisees and scribes asked him, 'Why? Why? Why do your disciples not walk according to the tradition of the elders?'" Now, the Pharisees had come on a special mission. They traveled 100 miles on foot from Jerusalem, all right, to Gennesaret, to find out, on a fault-finding mission. I call it fault-finding. So they were looking at Jesus, you know, they were standing there, just observing. Ha! They didn't do this. Okay lah, then they go and check all their thesaurus and Bible and law, everything. What it says, everything. They got everything right already. Then they approach Jesus. Why do your disciples not wash? Okay, let me tell you. What is the tradition of the elders? How they wash their hands, all right, is you need to, you, this is, that means when they, what before they eat, right, they must take some water, there is enough to fill 2 eggshells at least, to pour from the fingers down towards the wrist, and then they use the clenched fist to scrub, you know. And then after that, they have to do it the other way, from the wrist down to the fingers. So it's all this ceremony, and it's very ceremonial, because most of the time, they already wash their hands first. Then only they do this ceremonial washing before they eat. Okay? Very, very tedious lah. But eat bread with unwashed hands. And so they were worried, they were concerned about defilement of if your hands are dirty, right? When you eat the food, right? Go in, it makes you unholy before God. That's their concern. So very concerned about these things. Now, so that's the catalyst, the question that they ask Jesus. Notice that the question actually has 2 parts. The first part is, why do they not follow the tradition, right? The second part is, must wash your hands. 2 things, okay? So the perspective that Jesus wanted them to see, he answered and said to them. So Jesus answered and said to them, well did Isaiah prophesy of you hypocrites, as it is written, okay? Jesus never gave them, the answer to your question is, they already washed their hands earlier, yeah, you just didn't see only lah. Or they have the special, nowadays got the alcohol hand wash, the gel. They use that and wash, so no need to use water. Kill all the germs already. No, he didn't say that. They asked a question, and he straight away rebuked them. Right? He got to the bottom of the issue. And the issue is this. These people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. And in vain they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men. Now, Jesus was quoting from Isaiah chapter 29, verse 13. All right? From the prophet Isaiah. What is interesting, so I went to go and do a cross-reference, right? I said, is it exactly quoted this way? And actually, this, in vain they worship me, is not in Isaiah 29. So Isaiah 29 reads, these people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. The fear of me is taught by the commandments of men. That's the exact quotation. So, it's not directly said that in vain they worship me. And so what was the perspective that Jesus had about this? He was saying, you see, they had so many things that they needed to do in order to approach God, for God to accept them. All right? So many things. You must do this, must do this, must do this, a lot of things. But Jesus was saying, in vain. This word vain here is actually from the Greek word matan, all right, which means fruitless. All right, fruitless. That means this worship yields nothing. In vain. There is no result from this. There is no fruit. There is no effect. You're wasting your time. Okay, this is the exact word, in vain. And then he said, all too well you reject the commandment of God that you may keep your tradition. So Jesus was saying that you are so focused on the things that you make people do. Now, okay, the interesting thing is this. When I went, I also did a bit of a check in Leviticus, you know, and in Numbers, talking about the different washing, right? It doesn't talk about washing of cultures, you know, there. It doesn't talk about washing, actually the washing of pitchers and all these things, right? In the original law, when they wanted to go into the tabernacle to worship God, they need to wash with water their bodies and their clothes before they go in. That's all it says. Wash with water. Okay? But now they're saying, you must wash the fork and the spoon and the pots and the pans and everything. So they made it so difficult. So elaborate. The mind is focused on the washing, not focused on God. Do you understand that? So God is not interested in that. And you see, this I would like to say this, right? This is not just speaking only to the Pharisees, so to speak. All right? In our context today, sometimes, or rather in the past, all right, we were very caught up with, you must do a lot of things, you must, you know, before you have, when you have your quiet time, you must have, don't know what, confession first lah, then don't know what lah, then don't know what and what and what and what before you can go to God. Huh? It's a little bit like this lah, little bit. What is God's heart actually? What actually is God's heart? And it, between these verses, God actually says, or Jesus actually told them, you tell people all these traditions you must keep, right? But then in your tradition, you say that if your father or mother needs help, your father or your mother needs help, but you don't want to help them, let's say you don't want to help them. You can say, all these things, extra money, I got extra money to help you. This one actually all dedicated to God one. So sorry lah, no money to help you, all dedicated to God. Very holy, you know. Don't you think we need to honor God? Yes. So I cannot help you, Lord. That's the way that they actually did it. And it is interesting to note, because Jesus said that they did many other such things, right? But Jesus only brought up this instance. Only brought up this example. Why did he only bring up this example of not helping the parents? Not honoring your father or your mother? So I was just thinking about this. Actually, honor your father and mother is the first law with what? With a promise attached. Honor your father and your mother that you may live long, it may go well with you. Right? Honor your father and mother. And what is the basis of that? What is the basis? What was the purpose of the commandment of God? What was the purpose that the law was given? What was the purpose? Apart from the fact, the purpose is to bring man to the end of himself. We know, right? That means you can never keep the law. But what was the core of the law? So this is the standard that God expects us to live by. In Romans 13:10, it says, love worketh no ill to his neighbor. Love, therefore, is the fulfillment of the law. So what is actually the basis of the law? The basis of the law actually is love. You will not covet your neighbor's wife. You will not steal. You will not kill. All these things, why? It is because of love for the other person that you won't do it, right? So let me put it this way. How many of you here got hobbies? Hobbies that you love, that you really love. Anyone got hobby that you really love? Can you raise your hand? I only see three people. Everyone else, oh no. Hobbies that you really, really love. Okay? Now, okay, I like golf. I love golf. Okay, so I just use golf as an example. In the commandment of golf, it says you must practice chipping and putting every day for 3 hours. And then you must go to the driving range and hit 1,000 balls every day. So to someone, right, who is not a golfer, you would think, cheesy na, wow, you think, you think like that, right? But to me, if I could, I would definitely do it. You don't need to ask me. I hit 2,000 balls for you. Why? Why? Because I love it. So, I am actually fulfilling the commandment of golf without even looking at the commandment of God. Correct or not? I love to do it. I want to do it. And so actually, right, if you love God truly and you know His heart because He is a God of love, you love your neighbor as yourself, you will automatically fulfill the commandments. You understand not? Perfect. But this is perfect love. You know, perfect love because God is perfect. You see? And so the people completely missed this point. They couldn't see it. They thought all the commandments must follow. But the heart of it, which is love, they had left out. And therefore, all their works were in vain. Because they can't even honor their father and their mother. And they use the law of God to validate their dishonor of their father and mother. Do you understand that? Huh? So this is what makes God really angry, you know. Because you are using the law of love that's supposed to show the character of God, which is love, to perform unlove to someone else. And this really drives God mad. Do you know, I got 4 kids, right? Sometimes they drive me mad. They drive my wife mad, you know. But I still love them. Okay, so let's move on. Okay, so Jesus then continued. So this, he talked about the law first, right? So he talked about the law first, the purpose of the law. Or rather, he mentioned the purpose of the law, and I'm explaining to all of us here, lah. Okay, why he was so angry. Then he talks about washing or cleanness or cleaning, right? He said, there is nothing that enters a man from outside which can defile him. But the things which come out of him, those are the things that defile a man. This is revolutionary to the Jews at that time, you know. I tell you, they all also bung, you know. So they were so blur that Jesus had to say it 3 times, you know. Okay, so the first one, what comes out of a man is what defiles a man. Then he says, you're looking blur. You got it now? Hello. What comes out of a man is the thing that defiles a man. Then the guy still looking at him. What comes out of a man is what defiles a man, not what goes in. So when I was reading this, I also blur, you know. What comes out of a man? I also blur. You know, sometimes when you read the Bible, I don't know how to say this. I'm also trying to teach my children about reading the Bible. When we read the Bible, the first glance is sometimes you just read through, you know, it didn't really impact you. You know, you have to read through a few times. It's like an onion. You know onion? When you peel the first layer, at the same spot, there's another layer. You peel, then there's one more layer, and every layer is different. Correct or not? When you read the Bible is like that. You read the same. I've read from since young until I've read this how many times, you know. And yala, you know, defile the man, that's it lah. So I was asking, this time I read also like that, you know. I said, God, how tomorrow, sermon tomorrow. Sorry, No lah, okay, I got this on Friday lah. Friday, I was like, finally, the Lord showed me. And so, the thing I'd like to say is this. Jesus was saying, what comes out of a man is what defiles a man. And he wasn't speaking to only the Pharisees. He was speaking to the multitude, and he was speaking to his own disciples. And so, what is the point here? The point is, actually, Jesus is speaking to all of us. And the message is, no one, whatever what is in you, no one can qualify. Whether you're a Pharisee or not a Pharisee or whatever, you cannot qualify. Because what is inside you is your flesh. You understand or not? So whatever you do will never be clean on your own. On your own. And then the Lord showed me. He said, the Spirit just reminded me. He said that, you know, when Jesus, after Jesus said this, right? Then he walked off, you know. All right? He dropped the mic. No, okay. Those of you who get that saying, you know. Jesus basically said, after he said, all those evil things come out from within and defile a man. Thank you very much. Then he walked off. That's literally what happened. So then people, you know, no solution. So the catalyst, the perspective, and the standard that I've just been talking about, in case you don't know what I'm talking about, point to one thing. The law could only diagnose. It cannot cure. You get it or not? So when Jesus was speaking this to the people, it was during the time that he was walking on earth before the cross. Do you see it? And there was no solution at that time. Yet. In terms of man's timing. And so, this whole passage, Jesus was just telling you the futility of man, the condition that we were in without him is futile. Whatever law serves to show you how bad you are, how far you have fallen from him, how you are bankrupt and not able to fulfill it. You even got the main purpose of the law wrong, you know. You know what I mean, or? The people just couldn't see. But that was the very reason that Jesus was walking on this earth. Because he was going to carry the cross to Calvary and he was going to change this situation for all of us. Amen? So that's why Jesus stopped there. Because he's not going to tell them what he's going to do. He was just going to do it. And the cross changed everything. And I would like you to note that the sister passage or the parallel passage to Mark chapter 7 is Ephesians chapter 5. This one blew me away, okay? I didn't know it. I was just doing a search on washing. Because talking about washing hands. So take note, go back and read Ephesians 5. I read Ephesians 5 many times also. All right? I would like to start with Ephesians 5, 25 to 27. The way that Ephesians 5 is done is also the other way. That means it talks about the washing at the end. When Mark 7 talks about the washing at the beginning, Ephesians 5 talks about washing at the end. Okay, so husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her, that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of water by the word. This word actually is in Greek, is the rhema. It's called rhema. All right? Rhema means the spoken word of God. The spoken word of God. Washing her with the spoken word of God. That he might present her to himself, a glorious church, not having spot. Spot also don't have, microscopic spot. You are so clean that you don't even have a microscopic, nanoscopic spot on you. Do you get that or not? You are so super duper clean. There is no spot or wrinkle or any such thing. That one covered everything, just in case spot. Wrinkle doesn't cover, got other things. He cover any other thing. I love the Holy Spirit, when he writes. He wants you to get the message. when Jesus died on the cross, His blood has cleansed you once and for all completely. Whiter than snow, no spot, no wrinkle, or any such thing. This is the completeness of Jesus' work on the cross, that she, the bride, should be holy and without blemish. He has washed us clean from the inside. The Pharisees were so caught up with washing as clean as they can from the outside. They must do it. We must do the washing from the outside. Hopefully, we are clean enough to do it, to stand before God. Jesus has washed us totally clean from the inside. His work is complete. And it is His work, not your work. You get it or not? You have no choice, you know. You believe in Jesus, you're clean already. You get it or not? Just as men could not wash themselves clean, no matter how hard they tried when they were in sin, how can you say you can be dirty when Jesus has washed you? I think He's a better cleaner than you are, lah. Right? And so, I would like to also say this. Washing of water by the Word. Now, the Word is the Rhema word. You know, I was just spending some time with my daughter yesterday. Took her out for tea, you know. She's growing up. She happens to be eyeballing me right now. I didn't expect her to be here today. But you know, as my children grow up, I want them to experience the relationship that I have with my own Father, Heavenly Father. How to teach my children to love God? Read the Bible, pray, you know, do all the things that we used to be taught. You know, for me, what is it? And then I have been thinking this week as well, you know, about life. You know, we are reading about people dying, murders, assassinations, bombings, everything, right? It's just bad news after bad news after bad news. Don't you feel it? Huh? The economic situation in Malaysia is not good now. You go to a shopping mall, you go and see, the retailers are suffering. Nobody buying stuff. Sale, 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 sale also nobody buy. Really, you know. And even for me, I'm finding myself, oh, yo, don't spend. Oh, better save, you know, better, you know, don't eat so expensive, cheaper a bit, you know. It's just this feeling of constriction, fear, not knowing what the future holds. I don't know how you all are feeling. Every one of us, in a sense, living in this world, we have this thing. This thing over us. And I would like to tell you that, you know, also the phone, that's why the phone, when you have the handphone is the last thing I see before I sleep, not my wife's face. Sometimes. Huh? They must turn the landscape function off, lock the screen so at least it doesn't flip, you know, right? Or sometimes you're reading like that, then drop on your face, pow, oh yo, pain. I don't know, a few, very good at sim. Siam, Cantonese is called sim. But what I mean is this, all the bad news in the world is coming straight to you, personalized into your room, into your brain, at the speed of light. Or at the speed of data. 20 gig speed. So we are hardwired to the psyche of the world. Do you understand or not? When the world feels depressed, we feel depressed. When the world feels happy, we feel happy. Right now, these days, everybody on the phone, everybody is like, we are all plugging into the matrix, you know. You know what I mean or not? Our thoughts are being controlled by what is happening in the world. And we don't realize this. And so some days you are just feeling depressed or whatever, right? And then you're trying to, oh God, how am I going to get out of this? Why am I feeling like that? You know, you're just feeling that way. Because we have to watch what goes into our minds. Because it is true in our mind that we choose to live in the spirit or live in the flesh. And this is what I think in the church camp we learn about. Pastor Joe Fortunato mentioned. About thinking about what you are thinking about. Think about what you are thinking about. Do an audit on your thoughts. And leading back to this passage, you thought I had gone off on a tangent. Washing of water by the word means when we see something, we are affected, when we are washed clean, Jesus said, when he washed the disciples' feet, right? He says, somebody who is washed clean does not need to bathe again. He only needs his feet to be washed because he's walking on the dusty roads. So only his feet need to be washed because he's already clean. All of us, as we traverse this world, as we journey through this world, our thoughts are being dirtied by the dust of this world. And so we need to constantly be cleansed by hearing the Rhema word of Jesus. That means every day, if you are feeling, you all talk about grace, about freedom, about, nice. And then now, every Sunday come to church, it's like the same again. Why is it like that? Questions that you may have in your mind. How come I'm still having problems at my workplace? Pressure, uncertainty, not sure how to do. God, are you really there? I'm telling you, this is something I'm thinking through. And I realize, I said that Jesus' work for us on the cross has not changed. It is the same. You have been washed completely. You are clean. But you need to hear the word every day. Hear the word every day. And I realized, right, when I meditate on God's word, when I spend time, and I realize that spend time means just spending time, thinking about it, what does it mean here? Why like that? Ding dong ding, just thinking about it. And I find the Lord speaking to me. I hear Him clearer when I'm, during the week, I'm preparing a sermon. I hear Him very clearly, Let me give you an example. Still got a lot of time, okay? Let me give I hope you're enjoying this. Are you okay? Nobody feeling very boring? I hope not. Okay, so this week, I for marketing work in my work, doing sales and all that, right, corporate, I play golf with a group of people at a golf club, and very influential and billionaires and all this, and all senior and all this. So we play golf, all that, And I'm the youngest guy in the group. All of them also say, "Wow, you are the youngest guy in this group." It's a golf group, and they close the membership, and I happen to be the last person to join. Again, I think it's a favor of God. And so, I sometimes they see me no up. I can feel it. I hope you understand that. They see me no up. That means you young guy, you don't know who, the age of my son, I don't know who he is, why is he here, the feeling I get, the feeling like that. And so I went to an open house by a very renowned Tan Sri, not very renowned, very influential, so relative of who and who and everything. So in Taman Duta on Friday night, open house. And then there, as I was talking to him, then he's a heart surgeon. And so my uncle, all right, in Australia, is also a renowned neurosurgeon. And every time I mention his name to the medical faculty, all of them, he's your uncle, All of them like that, And so I felt the need to mention my uncle's name to this guy to get recognition. And the funny part is when I mentioned, he was like, who? That's the funny part, And so I was just feeling a bit funny, Just before I left, I mentioned, So I went off. And in the car, I turned on the music, just about to go home at night. And then the music came on. New Creation Church, one of the songs. You're my glory. You're my glory. You're my glory and the lifter of my head. And the Holy Spirit said, let me be the one that promotes you. When the time is right, I will lift up your reputation. People will know you. Don't do it yourself. You know, I mean, when the Lord speaks to you, driving in the car, yes, Lord. Okay, so, you know, I was like, yeah, what was I thinking? You know, sometimes we are so, internally, I thought, I felt like a small kid, you know. You know, I did something wrong. Right? Actually, I knew, you know why. But it's so refreshing to hear the Spirit's voice. That I know He's there with me. I don't need to worry about self-promotion. I just do my thing. Even if you don't promote me also, okay. I'm at peace. I'm not trying to gain people's favor. You let God do the promotion for you. You are His son, you know. He loves you. All right? And so that was something that I learned. Example, as an example of being washed in the Word, hearing His voice. So, you see, if you listen to the Word, sometimes you totally, the whole week, no Word at all. Then you say, God, why are you not speaking to me? Oh, I feel so dry. It's just like this. I think, I don't know. Okay, so there's this guy. God, help me win the lottery. God, help me win the lottery. First week, nothing. Praying every day. God, help me win the lottery. Help me win the lottery. Next week, nothing. God, help me win the lottery, baby. Finally, he heard a voice from God. Could you just go and buy a lottery ticket? Meet me halfway, can or not? That's a joke, joke. I'm not saying buy the lottery, okay, please. I'm just saying that you say, God, you're not speaking to me. God, you're not speaking to me. God said, hello, how many Bibles you have at home? In your phone also got how many 10 versions? Just read lah. I'm waiting to speak to you. God is waiting to speak to all of us. But you need to be in the right mind to hear Him. A mind that, you know, so you as you read the Word, He will talk to you about other things, you know. I'm reading about the washing, you know, the Pharisees and the, you know, defilement coming from inside, not outside. I'm reading about all these things. But God is talking to me about other things. You get it or not? And so, okay, moving on. This week, what really hit me, so this is Johan and Michelle, who got married on Thursday, all right? And as I was preparing this sermon, when I opened Ephesians chapter 5, and I saw washing of the Word, all right? But in context of what? Husband and wives. In context of Christ and His bride, the church. Then the Holy Spirit, yeah, you had a wedding this week, ma? I'm like, yeah. You know, the timing of it, how He, you know, just kind of through the Word, just the experiences you had, wow, yeah. He loves us, you know. As a new groom loves his bride, God loves you. God loves you. And, you know, what was the verse that Jesus quoted? You hypocrites, you acknowledge me with your lips, but your hearts are far from me. That was the Old Testament, the Old Covenant. In the New Covenant, we are in an intimate relationship with Him. We are one with Him. Our hearts are not far from Him. You may feel that you are far from Him. But He is telling you, hello, I'm still here, lah. You may feel that you are far from Him, but you and Him are one. Together. You need to know that. No matter how far you're feeling. Right? The other interesting point is that He said, you all don't honor your father and mother on earth. He was talking about on earth. But do you know that our Heavenly Father, we also didn't honor our Heavenly Father. But our Heavenly Father honored us first. He made a public declaration on the cross that we were worth the sacrifice of His Son. He honored us, you know. When we dishonored Him, He honored us. And this is grace. This is love. The love that He has for us. And now, in the past, following the commandments, we are trying so hard to keep the commandments, we are slaying our brothers and sisters left and right. Unable to love them. But we are now able to walk in love. And so this is an exhortation for us here today. Ephesians chapter 5, again, now is beginning, the first verse. Therefore, be imitators of God as dear disciples? No, as dear children. You are now His children. And walk in love as Christ also has loved us and given Himself for us. In the past, the law said you must do it. Honor your father, do this, do this, do this, do this. But there was no example for them. No example. In the new covenant, Jesus is our example. All right? God never asks us to do something that He has not already done. As Christ also has loved us and given Himself for us. And then this is the interesting part. Do you notice that in the defilement part, talking about lewdness and all these things in Mark 7, it's also mentioned in Ephesians 5. It says, but fornication and all uncleanness or covetousness, let it not even be named among you, as is fitting for saints. The last one, he's saying, all the defilement that comes out of you, you have no choice. All this lewdness and all the fornication, everything is part of who you are. You have no choice. But now, under the new covenant, it's an exhortation to us to say, hello, Christ washed you, cleaned you, loved you. This is not who you are. All these bad habits that you have in the flesh is not you. It is your flesh. All right? We are able to walk in love. We are able to walk in light. Ephesians 5, 8 to 10. For you were once darkness. So if you read Ephesians, it's just continuing, okay? It's just continuing. For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. God is saying, you are no longer defiled. We did not become sinners because we sin. Or rather, we do not become a sinner when we sin. We sin because we are a sinner. Do you know the difference or not? Huh? A chicken clucks lah. Right? A chicken doesn't go moo. Okay, this one even my 2-year-old will understand. You are who you are. If you are defiled from inside, you are of the flesh, all these things will be. But if you are of the light, which you are now, then all these things are not you. You need to know this first. Then it will come out in your life. So Paul is exhorting. You were once darkness, but you are no longer darkness now. You are light. Walk as children of light. For the fruit of the Spirit in you, is in all goodness, righteousness, and truth. This is training session, you know. It's like the mummy velociraptor teaching the baby velociraptor what to do. You understand? You don't know velociraptor. Okay. Mummy tiger teaching the baby tiger. So the mummy tiger goes like that now. Do this. Whing! All the claws come out. The baby go. Whing! Right? Mummy, what's this for? This one is to slash your prey, then you can have nice kebab. Oh, can I slash coco? No, cannot. You understand or not? This is the Holy Spirit teaching us who you are. You have the Spirit living in you. You have all the fruits from the Spirit inside of you, waiting to come out. And so it's like a training for us. And so let our journey not be one of, ayo, where's the money going to come from? Ayo, this one how? Ayo, my investment not good. Ayo, my job, I'm suffering. Holy Spirit is wanting to teach you so much more, you know, about the power that is inside of you. And He wants to take us to the next level, the next level, the next level. Finding out what is acceptable to the Lord. Oh, I love this. You know, we used to think, we must please God. Oh, you must do this to please God. Oh, you must do this to please God. When you think about it, right? You know, my little girl, she just stand there, do nothing, also please me, you know. You know what I mean? Huh? She go, I also feel happy. She go, I also feel happy. She go, I also feel happy. Because she's so cute. Because she is my daughter, la. You see parents on Facebook all posting only pictures of their own children, right? Huh? Because your own kid is the cutest to you. And do you know that you are the cutest to your Heavenly Father? If He has placed that very basic fatherly, motherly, parental instinct for you, for your children, how can you say that He's not like that? You understand or not? Because that is His heart for you. He wanted you to know how He feels about you. So He let us have children so that we have that kind of love for children. Then He tells you, that is how I feel about you. Do you get it? He loves you. Whatever you're going through today, be reminded when you look at your children, how proud you are of them. You know what wrong things they do, naughty, you just say, hey, naughty, this is not who you are. Don't do like that. You must do like that, right or not? It's not, I disown you. You go out of the house, no longer my kid. Never. Would you even dare to do that to your kids? Huh? You won't even think about it, lah. You think your Heavenly Father worse than you are. Okay? So what is this finding out what is acceptable? In King James, it says proving what is acceptable. Proving. And this is the point. There is no formula with how God deals with all of us. For example, the way God deals with me and speaks to me may not be the way that He deals with you and speaks to you. You understand or not? May not be the way that He deals with someone else and speaks to someone else. Just like the way I deal with my eldest daughter is not the way I deal with my youngest daughter. It doesn't mean I love one more than the other. I love both all the same. It doesn't mean I treat my son the same way I treat my daughter. Understand or not? Because their character is different. And a relationship is one where two parties interact. You get it? There are some people like to talk a lot. Talk. So what does the father do? Listen lah. Then there are some that don't talk a lot, want to hear things. Then the father talk lah. It's an interaction, you understand or not? It is a two-way communication. Maybe God not talking to you because maybe you're talking too much. He's listening lah, right? I don't know, right? Huh? So all I'm saying is, all right, relax. Our walk with the Lord is a relationship. It's really a beautiful walk in this world, you know. All the challenges that you face, right, are an opportunity for God to show you how much He loves you. Because if there are no challenges at all, you won't grow. Do you understand? I mean, I'm. This is from what you know. I'm also thinking about, and so there is no formula, but I'm saying. The basic thing is that communication must be there. No, there's no relationship without communication, correct? And so when you read the word, you are filling your mind and your heart with the language that the Holy Spirit speaks. You can hear Him sharper. Listen to sermons on your way to work in a traffic jam, you know, worship songs. Just ask the Lord, you know, just feel, what do I feel like now? Listen to this music, you know, thank the Lord, praise Him. you know, read the word. You know, I was, I think about a month ago, I was feeling very down, you know, my work, a lot of stress and a lot of things going wrong, just solving problem after problem. You just solve 10 problems, another 10 problems come. You know, it's just operational, you know. I found it so burdensome. And I told my wife, you know, every day, got so many problems, you know. It's such a big burden to me, you know. I was just complaining to her. And then, you know, just feeling at night cannot sleep properly, all this. And then I woke up in the morning to go to the to wash up. Then I normally, while sitting on the great white throne, you know, I will read the verse for the day or to, you know, just, you know, first thing in the morning that I do, right? So I just open, and the verse that jumped out was in Psalm. It says, "I am the Lord who bears your burdens for you every day." Can you imagine? The night before, I was just saying, I got so many burdens, you know. Every day I got burdens, you know. The next morning, the first thing I read from the word, "I am the Lord your God who daily bears your burdens." Wow. That totally changed my day. You know, it changed my day. When I just reminded, yeah, He carries my burdens. Every day He's carrying, you know. Huh? Like I gave this example before. You're carrying a very heavy burden walking down the road. Then somebody comes along in a nice lorry and says, "Let me send you to the market." Then you climb up on the lorry and go to market still carrying your burden. You'll get it or not? Standing on the lorry, holding the burden. So heavy. Let your burden down. Cast your care on Him, for He cares for you. Amen? So finding out every day, you learn in your relationship with Him. We are now able to walk in wisdom. Walk in love, walk in light, walk in wisdom. Ephesians 5, 14 to 17. He says, "Hello, wake up, my children. Wake up, awake, you sleeper." It's like arising out of a dead sleep. Sometimes my children also like that, sleeping in the morning, you know, go to school. Wake up, wake up. That's what God is saying to us. Wake up. Wake up to who you really are. Don't live life blur, or in drunkenness, or in depression, or, you know, live life like just going with the flow. That's not what He has called you to. He is a God of power. He is a God of... the Bible says He has not given us a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power, of love, and of a sound mind. Having mental discipline, keeping yourself sharp, all the time thinking, you know. And I'm not saying force yourself. I'm saying when you read the Word of God and you are listening to Him, you are sharp. Whenever an opportunity comes, yes or no, you make a decision faster, quicker, sharper. You know, He's the one that brought. You were just, you know what I mean? I'm just asking the Lord. I say, "Lord, maybe I need a new investment. Can I, you know, maybe buy a house?" And then the Lord brings a house. Sharp. You know that when you pray and then He answers, you know it's from Him. You understand not? If you didn't pray, He just dropped, then you think, don't know whether it's from Him or not, or right. But when you ask Him and then it comes, then, hey, oh, of course, from Him lah. Huh? "See then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is." So this is a continuation. In case you are wondering why I went from Mark chapter 7 and now I'm in Ephesians 5, I'm just telling you that you cannot read one without the other. Okay? Because it was the old covenant all the way to the new covenant. This is how He has enabled us to live with His Spirit inside of us. And so in summary, Mark 7 versus Ephesians 5. The flesh's focus is on external cleansing. Jesus has totally cleansed us from inside. The flesh is far from God, but we are in an intimate relationship. The flesh is naturally corrupt, lazy, and undiscerning. We should wake up and live circumspectly, live wisely, live in love, live in light, live in wisdom. Because it's not for us to must live, you know. You are already there in that realm. Wake up. Exercise what has been given to you. Amen? You got it? Hallelujah. Let's rise. Heavenly Father, I thank you for today's word. And I believe that it has encouraged us, it has spoken to us to wake up from our stupor, wake up from the blurness sometimes we find ourselves in. And how to wake up? It is in reading the word every day, being washed by your Rhema word, hearing your voice in our lives. And Lord, you speak wonderful things to us. When we are discouraged, you encourage us. When we feel maligned by people or put down by people, you are the lifter of our head. Jesus went through all the suffering on this earth. He walked the Via Dolorosa to the cross. That walk to Golgotha, carrying the cross, he was thinking of you, thinking of all of us. And you made a very public declaration on the hill 2,000 years ago that you love us, that you would give anything to get us back. And you gave the life of your Son. I thank you, Father, that for all of us who are here, Father, that you will speak to us, quicken us inside our spirit, that we may be able to hear your voice clearly. And even as we are exhorted today to realize that we are now children of light, that we may live in wisdom, that we may watch what we allow into our minds, that we may have input from your word rather than input from the world all the time. And that even as we find that, as we do that, as we exercise it, we will find more and more power, victory coming in that we are over the circumstances, because we are like eagles flying in the sky. We are not like chickens on the ground. We are eagles soaring together with you. And you are the Papa Eagle teaching us how to exercise the authority, exercise the power, exercise the love that you have given to us. Lord, we don't want to be part of this world system. We are living in the world, but we are not of the world. We don't want to have all every day thinking about what the rest of the world thinks. Worrying about money, worrying about food, worrying about a job, all these things. Jesus says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Our focus should not be part of all these things. And when our focus is all these things, we find that we are down and depressed and worried and anxious. It's because we are focusing on the wrong thing. I thank you, Father, that you have given us the new way. You have shown us the way to live above the clouds, to soar with you. And you have given us all we ever need in this journey. I pray for all my brothers and sisters here today, from the youngest to the oldest, Lord, that we may hear this clarion call. We hear this call of our Father calling out to us, wake up, my child, wake up to the destiny that I have for you. One of power, one of love, one of a sound mind. That we may take the positions that you have given to us, that we may effect your work, speaking light and love and power into the lives of those who are desperately needing it, Lord. Lord, whatever finances you give to us, Father, it is for you. It's for you to bless others. Lord, as we learn to live and trust in you, Lord, not trusting in our savings or trusting in our bank balance, but we trust in you that provides everything for us. Whatever we need, you provide. Just in time. We don't need to worry about the ringgit falling against the other currencies or the interest rate going up on our loans, all these things. These are all the dust of the world. Father, I pray, Lord, for all of us here, for myself, Father, that you open our eyes even as we have stepped into the new covenant, the understanding of the new covenant, that you teach us to live in the new covenant, to live as your children, the children of the Most High, that we will have wisdom that people do not have, that we will have discernment that people do not have, that we will have power that people do not have, that we will have peace that the world cannot understand. And it's not because of us, it's because of the Spirit that lives in us, the Spirit of Jesus Christ. And Father, I just thank you, Lord, for this call for all of us today to rise up. And I thank you that this will be the beginning of the journey for some of us. As we hear the call, we come back to you and say, Father, how are you wanting us? How is your relationship with me? I thank you, you love me. I want to find out what is pleasing to you. I want to find out how much you love me. I want to find out how you interact with me. It's so special. It's so intimate. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you, Lord, that as we learn this today, Lord, that we will see a release in our lives. Father, we will see a new flow in our lives. Lord, sometimes we don't know what to do. We feel like, you know, what is it that we need to do? Lord, we thank you that it is a learning process. Bit by bit, little by little, more and more, we will learn to hear the leading of the Spirit in our lives. And that we will always flow in the peace of God, which passes understanding. And for those of us here who have not accepted Jesus as your Savior, and you say, wow, what you have said is exactly what I need in my life. I want you to say this prayer, and then you to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. As you make this declaration, you believe in your heart, you have become a child of the King, into the kingdom of light and of love. So follow after me. Heavenly Father, I thank you that Jesus died for me to free me. All the uncleanness that I had has been totally washed clean. And now I am part of the bride. I am the beloved. You love me so much. I accept Jesus as my Lord and Savior. And I'm excited to live this new life under the guidance of the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.